My voice, for I have called to you. Be my help. Do not abandon or forsake me, O God, my Savior. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good morning.
Good morning, Father.
Today, in the first reading, we hear about the passing of the power and the spirit of Elijah to Elisha. That the spirit of the saints and the prophets will come into our hearts. Let's begin this Mass by asking forgiveness for our sins, for our lack of zeal and the service of the Lord. Let's ask His mercy.
Lord Jesus, you were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You intercede for us constantly at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, strength of those who hope in you, graciously hear our pleas. And since without you, human, mortal frailty can do nothing, grant us always the help of your grace, that in following your commands, we may please you by our resolve and our deeds. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Book of Kings. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, he and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Please stay here. The Lord has sent me on to the Jordan. As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you," Elisha replied. And so the two went on together. 50 of the guild prophets followed. And when the two stopped at the Jordan, they stood facing them at a distance. Elijah took his mantle, rolled it up, and struck the water, which divided, and both crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed over, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask for whatever I may do for you before I am taken up from you." Elisha answered, "May I receive a double portion of your spirit?" ask something that is not easy, Elijah replied. Still, if you see me taken up from you, your wish will be granted. Otherwise, not. As they walked on conversing, a flaming chariot and flaming horses came down between them, and Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. When Elisha saw it happen, he cried out, my father, Israel's chariots and drivers. But when he could no longer see him, Elisha gripped his own garment and tore it in two. Then he picked up Elijah's mantle that had fallen from him and went back and stood at the bank of the Jordan. Wielding the mantle that had fallen from Elijah, Elisha struck the water in his turn and said, where is the Lord, the God of Elijah? When Elisha struck the water, it divided, and he crossed over. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let your hearts take comfort, all who hope in the Lord.
Let your hearts take comfort, all who hope in the Lord.
How great is the goodness, O Lord, which you have in store for those who fear you, and which, toward those who take refuge in you, you show in the sight of the children of men.
Let your hearts take comfort, all who hope in the Lord.
Let your hearts take comfort, all who hope in the Lord. You hide them in the shelter of your presence from the plottings of men. You screen them with your abode, within your abode, from the strife of tongues.
Let your hearts take comfort, all who hope in the Lord.
Love the Lord, all you his faithful ones. The Lord keeps those who are constant, but more than requites those who act proudly.
Let your hearts take comfort, all who hope in the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Whoever loves me will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him.
Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, take care not to perform righteous deeds in order that people may see them. Otherwise, you will have no recompense from your heavenly Father. When you give alms, do not blow a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, to win the praise of others. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right is doing, so that your almsgiving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will repay you. When you pray, do not be like the hypocrites who love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on street corners so that others may see them. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go to your inner room, close the door, and pray to your Father in secret. And your Father, who sees in secret, will repay you. When you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites. They neglect their appearance so that they may appear to others to be fasting. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, so that you may not appear to others to be fasting, except to your Father who is hidden. And your Father, who sees what is hidden, will repay you. My sisters and brothers, this is the good news, the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I have probably told you this story from the trenches before, but it's been a while. Several years ago, a lady called me from another diocese to talk to me about a problem they were having in their prayer group in the parish. And as she laid the problem out, it appeared to be fairly serious. And she was asking my advice. And I said to her, do you have a core group in the parish? In the prayer group, rather. A core group is a smaller group within the prayer group that's really committed. They share in the leadership. They pray for the prayer group and the prayer meeting in the parish, etc. And she said, yes, we do. And I said, well, okay, well, I'm not in your diocese, so isn't this something that your core group should address? And as soon as I said that, she sighed from way down deep inside. I could hear it over the phone. It was a sigh of frustration, a sigh of concern. And she said, Deacon Bill, you know, it's the same old problem. Everybody wants to be the leader, but nobody wants to lead. I don't know if she knew that she had just put her finger on one of the oldest problems in the history of the church. In fact, one of the oldest problems in salvation history. Doing the holy things for the wrong reason, or reasons. When I was a kid, the nuns used to tell us, and this takes me back to second grade, third grade, about doing a morning offering. And they were right. And it's a good thing to consider doing if you're not already doing it. What do you imagine would happen if every morning when we came to this altar, you placed on the altar, I placed on the altar, everything we have and all that we are? What do you think would happen if we were to say to the Lord, here I am, with whatever I have, I give it to you right here. And if I'm struggling with a problem or two, I'm going to put the problem here on the altar before you and ask you to intervene and help me take care of it. What do you imagine would happen if we went out those doors every day and did what St. Paul said to do in his letter to the Colossians? Whatever you do, do it in the name of Jesus. Now think about the implications of that. Whatever you do, if you're washing dishes, do it in the name of Jesus. If you're taking care of your family, do it in the name of Jesus. If you're preparing dinner, do it in the name of Jesus. If you're out there in the community doing your job, if you're lucky enough to have a job, do it in the name of Jesus. Keep the focus on Jesus, in other words, not on you. In our gospel reading, Jesus is talking about that old problem. Don't do these holy things because you want people to see you doing it. That's the wrong reason for doing it. But do it so that the attention is drawn to God, to Jesus, to the Spirit in you. St. Paul wrestled with this problem when he wrote his first letter to the Corinthians. This is 20, 30 years after the resurrection of Jesus. They already have the problem. The Corinthians seem to have taken this problem, doing holy things for the wrong reason, to an extreme. My gift is more important than your gift. My gift is more holy than your gift. Look at me. The focus was on me, not on the Lord. And we have to be careful of that. This is especially true of people who are in ministry, whatever the ministry is, because it can be a very subtle temptation. We may not even be aware we're doing it, to slip over the line into doing it because it feels good for me, or doing it because I like to be up here in front of people, doing it because I like the affirmation they give to me. But if we're doing it in the name of Jesus, our day can be an incredible adventure, because as I like to say it, you never know what opportunity is going to be presented to you to share the good news of Jesus. You never know who's going to cross your path and where. You may hear that tug in your heart. Speak to that person. Tell that person a word of hope, of encouragement, etc. Whatever it is. That's something you and I can do every day. It may sound simple. It may sound trite. I believe what Jesus really wants from you and from me is that we literally give ourselves to him for his purpose, for his pleasure. I believe he would have us say to him, do with me today whatever you will to do. Grant me the grace to recognize it when it happens. And maybe a good prayer would be, whatever you have me do today, Lord, grant that it bring ever more glory to your name and ever more of your love to your people. If we were to do that, take it seriously, it would revolutionize our lives, because it would free God to do within us what he's always wanted to do, which is live his life in us, empower us through his Spirit to do what Jesus did, and empower us to be effective witnesses, effective evangelizers. Would everybody out there like it? No, never been that way. And it isn't that way today. Would there be people walking away from us saying, this person is crazy? Probably. Just may happen that you will be the instrument God will use to bring somebody out of darkness into light. That's the call of an effective disciple. And we're all called to intentional discipleship. Not just following after Jesus like we're in a parade, but doing what Jesus does. Reaching out, serving, speaking that word, the word of the Lord, in whatever the situation is that we're facing. Elisha asked Elijah for a double portion of his spirit. I wonder what that would feel like. Grant me a double portion of your spirit, Lord. Double portion of your fire. Double portion of your gifts, your charisms. Double portion of power. And he did it. He got it. Jesus is talking here in the gospel about that problem. Don't let other people know what you're doing. Here we are gathered together and everybody sees what we're doing. Do it in secret so that your Father who sees in secret knows what you're doing and will reward you.
Let's pray for our Pope Francis, for Bishop Ireland.
Elijah, who was taken up into heaven for all from us that will be holy and truly live the faith that we claim, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Pray for each one of us in our spiritual lives that we will be humble and not do things for the wrong reason or to be seen. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who have died, especially in this Mass. We pray for the repose of the soul of Dafrim Ogunjin and for all of our loved ones who have gone before us, that they will be taken up into the joy of heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father, hear these prayers offered now at the altar of Christ our Lord, who lives forever and ever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, and become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, and become our spiritual drink. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God and the Almighty Father. O God, who in the offerings presented here provide for the twofold needs of human nature, nourishing us with food and renewing us with your sacrament, grant, we pray, that the sustenance they provide may not fail us in body or in spirit, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. His death we celebrate in love, his resurrection we confess with living faith, and his coming in glory we await with unwavering hope. And so with all the angels and saints, we praise you, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in Christ. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Your death, O Lord, and confess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Myron, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, our merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing through this life, give kind remittance to your kingdom. There, we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. us, Lord, we pray for every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I leave you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Lamb of God,
you take away.
Away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Thank you. Maybe you should call office to reserve to make sure that you have a place at Mass. And for the Spanish-speaking community, they have great devotion to the Sacred Hearts by having a special Mass in the evening at 7 o'clock in Spanish. But in English, of course, we have the 7 o'clock in the morning Mass. And so maybe call the office just to make sure. And if we have enough people, we can add another Mass, of course, in the evening. Eventually, we're going to be adding those evening Masses in English. We only have a 7 a.m. Mass, but since this is a big solemnity, please call the office to let us know if you're coming and to make a reservation, perhaps on the internet as well, to reserve or make sure that you have your place at the Mass on Friday, the solemnity of the Most Sacred Heart of Jesus. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Almighty God, bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Our Eucharistic celebration is ended, so let us go forth in love and joy to serve the Lord, one another, and all of those to whom he sends us.
Thanks
be to God.
Amen.